few days ago, I did an online Zoom demonstration for a lovely art group in San Diego, and they wanted a pen and wash raccoon. And here's the one over my shoulder. They very kindly sent me the recording so that I can share it with you. But unfortunately, the first 20 minutes got missed. So I'm going to explain what we did in those 20 minutes, and then we can get into the full session. It is a Zoom session, so the quality isn't brilliant, but you can see what's going on, you can hear what's going on. So I hope you find it useful, because it's all in real time and there's lots of discussion about various arty questions. My name is Liz Chadderton. I'm a watercolour artist based in Berkshire in the UK, and I love painting animals and birds. I started off by sharing the reference photo I was working from. This is from pixabay.com, so it's free to use with no copyright issues. And I explained that I'd cropped it in and slightly tilted it to get a more quizzical look for this lovely furry raccoon. We had a long discussion about raccoons and whether they were lovely or nasty. I then just said that I would be using technical pens, micron pens, in a couple of different widths, and that we were looking for pens with pigment ink in them, so that would make them waterproof and light resistant. And I explained that sometimes pens that are supposedly waterproof do actually move on certain papers, so that you do need to check that your pen and your paper are going to behave properly. I'd sketched out the image. This was my practice piece, which I showed them. And I said, first of all, I was going to start with ink and then add watercolour. And then if we had time, I would go for watercolour, then ink. I'd done a pencil sketch onto my paper, which is Bockingford, £140 with a cold press surface. This was the first piece I did with the ink first, and then we did really soft watercolour washes to get a super furry animal. We didn't have quite so much time for the second one, but this one was done with watercolour washes first, and then we added some watercolour pencil to make some of the whiskers, and we added the pen to just add a little definition, contours, and the form of the animal.
Sorry, my computer's just told me you're recording this. Sorry.
Yes, I forgot to start it at the beginning. Now I've just opened.
Oh, well, never mind.
If you want a more proficient master of ceremonies, you'll have to find another person.
I was going to say, can you get sacked when you're a volunteer?
I get sacked, yes.
Nah, I say, if you're a volunteer, you can get away with plenty of things. So I'm looking at this and working out the balance of how much, I want the ink to do. And I think I could stop here and get the watercolour on, and it would give just enough sort of tone. But I will do a little bit more. Because if I just go back to the one I did earlier, the amount of ink on this one is probably pretty much the amount of ink I've already got on here. So for myself, I think it'll be quite interesting to maybe do a little bit more work on this one, and then I can compare and look and think, yeah, I prefer that, or maybe not, or maybe I will go back to not so much or whatever. So for my own sort of personal challenge, I quite like playing around with what I do, so that I'm learning all the time, that I can think, oh yeah, I like that approach. Or some days I feel in a more detailed mood and I just want to get caught up in what I'm doing. And some days I'm like, no, I just want to splash the paint around and have some fun.
Liz?
So, yes.
We have a question from one of the artists. Says, do you ever use transfer paper and then go over it with the pen? instead of doing a pencil drawing first and so forth?
No, I love drawing, so I don't tend to use any sort of transfer methods unless I am doing a portrait of a person, and then I sometimes might use a light box, because suddenly when it's a person, we absolutely do recognize them. Whereas frankly, you know, if this raccoon does not recognize itself, you know, or this raccoon's mum doesn't recognize it, it doesn't matter, does it? I don't think it's ever going to see this portrait. Whereas if you were doing a portrait of a person, it really does have to have a likeness. So I just would sketch out. And as you say, as long as you sort of look at those horizontals and verticals, it really helps you get sort of the proportions in the right place. Or maybe say take the width of the nose and compare it to the widths of the markings, so that you get the basic proportions right.
Liz, how do you tell when your line work is done or should be done?
It's really a matter of judgment, and you know, looking and thinking, how much do I want to do? So as I say, I would really try and stop when you think you're at that sort of 85 to 90% position. So sometimes I will do loads and loads more line work just because that's how I feel at that point and I want detail. And then sometimes I would stop before now and say, no, that's enough. But I thought I'd better give you a little bit of value for money in terms of line work rather than sort of just giving you 10 minutes of it and stopping. So I'm probably doing more than I would.
So, of course, you can always go back after you do your wash. You can go back and look for a line down.
Absolutely. And I very much, that's why I was saying that, you know, do stop at 90%, because you can always go and do more, but you can't do less. So far, far better to stop early. And I will listen to my own advice and say, well, that's probably all I need. And at this point, I mean, the joys of these pens is, look, they dry immediately, it's dry. Whereas if I was using a dip pen and say Indian ink, that could take a while to dry and there's a danger that you're going to smudge it. So at this point, I get rid of my pencil. Sorry if this shakes the camera dreadfully, because I would love to create the illusion that I don't need a pencil under drawing and that I'm so clever that I can just do it straight off. You know the truth, but wouldn't it be nice if you could just sort of do it immediately? If I'm doing sort of urban sketching and things like that, I really try not to use a pencil and just go in with the ink, because it makes you far more decisive. You know, you can't do anything tentative, because once the ink's on the paper, you're stuck. So
is there a problem with using the eraser on the paper and disturbing the, you know, the surface of the paper?
No, I'm being quite gentle. You might not believe that, but I am being very gentle. This paper is very tolerant. It's Bockingford. It's a cellulose paper. It's not a cotton paper, but it's quite hard sized. It can put up with a lot of rough treatment, but I'm not being rough. And also, I mean, the erasers I'm using are just sort of white erasers, and they're actually very, very good. So I've never had a problem with
the brand. What is the brand of the paper again?
Ooh. Oh, Bockingford.
Bockingford.
Bockingford is a paper mill based in Somerset in the UK. I don't know if you can get it in America.
Yes, but you can get it in America, because Patrick Mason uses it and he loves it too. He's one of our local artists.
Oh, brilliant. Oh, yeah, I think it's just a really tolerant paper, so you can be rough with it, but it's also very cost effective. So it's a good quality. You know what you're getting. You don't get any surprises. It's cost effective, so it's archival. So, you know, it won't yellow with time. It's acid-free, etc. But it's not like buying a sheet of, I don't know, Fabriano paper that you think, oh, this sheet of paper cost me £15 or, you know, $15. And, oh, I mustn't muck it up, because that just makes you tighten up straight away. If you think, oh, this was expensive, I mustn't make a mess, you can guarantee that you will. So I like to buy very cost-effective paper that's good quality, so I can have a stack of it. I buy 50 sheets at a time, and that encourages me to experiment, to enjoy the process without thinking, oh, I've got to be so careful, you know. And I think that is a healthier attitude. This is only £140. I usually use, if I was doing a watercolour painting rather than the pen and wash, I might use, say, £200 just to stop it buckling. But, you know, that's heavy enough for me not to have to worry about it cockling too much or that sort of thing.
Yeah. You can get it on Amazon.
Oh, good old Amazon. What would we do without them? Sorry, I'm getting some paper, towels, just in case. So this is, as we've already spotted, you know, a super fluffy, lovely raccoon. So I'm going to do lots of wet in wet work. Colours wise, I squeezed them out into the palette before we started. And let me show you what I've chosen. I had it all on a piece of paper that I've, oh good, just to show that I've actually prepared. Let's put that there. So I've put some French ultramarine here, and some lovely quinacridone sienna, which is a Daniel Smith's. I am not loyal to any brand at all. So, you know, Daniel Smith's is gorgeous, but this is Jackson's, which is an own brand here, which is really nice. It's artist quality, but not half as expensive as Daniel Smith's, because over here, Daniel Smith's is just costs a fortune. I've put in a little bit of turquoise just in case I want to make it a bit more zhuzhy, just to jazz it up if needs be. I have got some burnt sienna there. Burnt umber, I should say. This is a gorgeous colour. I don't know if you're familiar with it. It's called Perilin Violet. It's just here, and it is such a beautiful colour. That's a Winsor & Newton. I have put some just translucent grey in here, but I probably won't use it. And just in case, say, I want to jazz things up, I haven't quite got it planned. It's a quinacridone magenta.
Liz, is the sienna quinacridone burnt sienna?
Just sienna, if I put that up there.
Okay.
Oh, if it can focus on it. There you go. Just a quin sienna, absolutely gorgeous colour. Fell in love with that one. So I love Daniel Smith's colours, but as I say, certainly in the UK, they are extortionately expensive. So I'm really selective about the ones I choose. So I will, they're the only people that do a quin sienna, but I would never bother buying Daniel Smith's French ultramarine because I can get that anywhere, sort of thing. So I'm quite selective about which Daniel Smiths I use.
What was the Perilin one?
That's Winsor & Newton. That is Perilin Violet. Sorry, you probably can't read that.
No, that's great. Thanks.
Absolutely gorgeous colour. Let me just show you on. That's the colour. So it's a really sort of gungy. Yes, gungy, sort of violety, purpley, just right. Lovely colour, really nice. Right.
like a mulberry or something.
Yes. Yeah, there's a real berry colour. It's lovely. And I mean, much as this skunk is grey, black and white, not skunk. I said the wrong thing there. That's our conversation. Raccoon. I thought we would just jazz him up, and I wanted to use different colours from the one I did before. So here, as you can see, I used lots more blues and some greys, and I mixed this colour out of dioxin violet and quin gold, and it makes a nice sort of browny, gungy, purpley colour. So I thought, you know, I want to do something a little bit different here, just for interest, and then we can compare and say, oh, which do I prefer? You know, do I like a warmer one, a cooler one? You know, what sort of mood am I in today? Brush wise, I'm just grabbing my brushes. I will probably use, that's a size 8, just a synthetic round brush, which I'll use for the eyes, because I want the eyes to be precise, whereas I want the rest to be all fuzzy and furry. I've got a really decent size brush, so that's a 2-inch, which I'll use for wetting just with clean water. And then I'll probably use some bat, which is sort of a size 16 round for putting the colour on. So again, 3 brushes, and maybe I will use a finer brush if I decide to use gouache on the whiskers, but you know, that will be absolutely fine. So I'm a big fan of tube colours, just because I like to do things quickly. You know, I don't want to be scrubbing away at sort of little pans of watercolour, and I do like working wet in wet. So on the whole, I let the colours mix on the surface, but I am going to mix that French ultramarine with the quin sienna to make a really dark. Can you see that, how rich that? So, but it's so much more interesting than if I just squeeze black out of the tube. I'm going to need lots of that. So let me scoop some of that blue in there and my quin, mix it up. If I put more sienna in, I get a brown. If I put more of the blue in, I'll get a far bluier grey. But that's a really nice combination. So what I would suggest if you're using tubes is always to get them mixed up to sort of a creamy consistency, because, oops, I obviously had some turquoise, which is just rather dulled down that magenta. That was naughty of me. But get them mixed up, because then if you know, something nice happens, you can take advantage of it. Whereas if, you know, you're painting away and something, you know, one of those lovely watercolour happy accidents happens, and but you've got to sort of mix up some more colour, then you've lost the opportunity, your paper's dried, it's all a bit too late. I say, I don't think I'll use a few of those colours, but I'll have them mixed so I can make those decisions as I go along. So I'll just pop those there. Right, I want to do the eyes, I say, quite precisely, so I'm using my size 8 round brush and just get those eyes in, because basically if the eyes don't work, the whole portrait doesn't work. Just getting them sort of in there. I've left the highlights, and I've simplified the highlights, just making sure that they are consistent between the two eyes. I'm going to just dry my brush off and then just take a little of that with that thirsty brush, just to make a little bit of variation there. And then a little of my dark mix I'm going to drop in the centre to mix. We can't really see its pupils at all, but we know they're sort of there. And probably don't need much more than that for the eyes. And you can see already, just putting those eyes in starts to sort of bring it to life. And I'll just leave those alone. Now, with clean water and my huge brush, I am going to basically brush over my painting or my drawing. So being careful of those eyes, but this is so I can get some lovely, furry, wet in wet effects. And you can see that the pen isn't going anywhere. But you can imagine if I hadn't checked the pen out and it all started to merge at this point, there would be a fair amount of panicking going on. So that's why it really would test your paper and your pen, because, as I say, certain papers just don't grip onto the pen as they should.
Liz?
Yes.
Do you always work flat?
No, especially for you. It's just easier because I've got the camera overhead. It's just easier. And usually I would just have it up propped on. I don't know, I usually use my reel of masking tape. So just prop it up at a couple of degrees, because that does help you predict where the water's going to go. The trouble with working flat is that water can go any direction, which could end up being an issue, but let's hope it doesn't. Now, this is quite wet, so I need to let some of this, can you see the shine on it? If I just move that around, you can see how much water's on. So I do need to let it just settle down a bit, because if I put colour on now, so, oh, actually, I thought it was going to explode off. No, I was going to say, if I put the colour on now, it'll go all over the place, but actually it's behaving itself. I'm going to have to mix up far, far more, because, of course, this huge brush, well, it's not huge, but a larger brush just sucks up all that colour. And
did you say what brush that was?
It's a size 16, sort of just around. It's actually a quill brush, but it's equivalent of a size 16.
Okay.
And again, if you're planning to paint in a fairly loose way, it's a good idea to use a large brush, one that feels a little bit too big. Now, you can see this starting to go for quite a wander to create some of that lovely furry effects. I'm going to have to make sure it doesn't take over. So that's why I needed my kitchen towel. So it is wandering into the area that's going to be white. So I'm just going to keep an eye on that. Say, I may have been a little bit sort of excited about getting some colour on. So it might have been a little bit too wet. But letting it go where it wants to go within reason is, you know, you get these lovely furry marks, which is just perfect for the rich coat that this raccoon has got. But I'm just slightly concerned that we will lose, like we're losing that lovely white mark above its eye there. So I'm just lifting that out and just saying that I'm in control of the water. Even though it thinks it's in control, it's not. So I've changed to the smaller brush to come round the eye, because I do want that to be relatively precise. And just letting some of these marks, again, if I hold that up, hold on, hopefully you can see those lovely furry marks. And the lovely thing about mixing your own black is that it splits out on the paper, and it's just so much more interesting than if I'd squeezed it out of a tube and just used a standard sort of dark. It would just be flat and boring. Whereas this way, I'm going to have little areas where the blue will show through and little areas where the sienna will show through. And it's just a lot more interesting. So I'm just coming back down there and again, pulling out a little bit more to get some of those marks. already I've used up all the blue I squeezed out, so I'm just going to put some more because I would like to have a few areas of pure blue just for fun. So I'm dropping that blue in there and letting that mix on the paper. And again, it's gone for a wander into its sort of muzzle, which is a white area. So I can just, you know, keep it in control. It's about letting the water doing its thing, but only where you want it to do it. So, you know, need to keep, always be aware of what the water's doing. And also just being aware, because it's now nice and warm in here, got the heating on. So, you know, how quickly are things drying? If I need to, I can always re-wet the area because I do want to let the watercolour really do its what it wants to do to get that furry edge. I can always use a little spray bottle like that if I need to move the colour more. Because that's, you see, that's drying down there. So I'm just going to, I could spray that. Ooh, if my spray would work. Ah, if you put water in a spray, it helps. Just fill that up. You know, that one, that's got some water in. Good. I'll just try not to spray myself. Okay. Oh, that's better. Yeah, water definitely does help. Right, let's come down here under its chin. And again, just it really has dried terribly quickly. So I'm just going to wet that a bit more. Don't mind that that bit isn't particularly dry because I'm getting sort of a more definite round the mouth is fine. And then just I can use the clean brush there. And I can, again, if I just need to recover a little bit of white round there, can always do that too. Managed to splosh there, but if I just get rid of that, that's okay. So at this point, it's all looking sort of quite fluffy, which is what I want. As it dries, I might deliberately try and encourage lots of little sort of cauliflowers and water blooms. But I don't want him to turn into a blob. So in certain areas, it would be a good idea to do some individual marks, make it just a little bit more interesting. Because if I did it all like this, it would, you know, potentially not be as interesting as if you do different marks. So this brush, even though it's big, it comes to a beautiful point, and we can use it to sort of just indicate some of that lovely fur that's going on. But if I think that's a bit too brushy, you know, I can soften some of those just with a spray. So, you know, I've got that as options. Right, let's come to the other side. And this might be a little bit more controlled because this paper has dried. Yeah, that's a better dampness of the paper because it's still having nice soft edges, but it's not going crazy, which is good. And I'm going to come up here. I want to soften up there around those lovely ears and get the dark centre of the ears in. And then join the shapes up. And then round here, you know, this isn't terribly interesting round here. It's just sort of, it can just sort of go for a wander round there. So let me move that over. It was making a run for it. So let me go back and just double check what bits should be white and what bits should be darker. So it needs to be really dark around the eye, but leaving little flashes of white as well. So pop that in there. And I had those nice sort of little surprise colours that I put in the palette. So that's a little bit of turquoise. I'm just going to drop it in there. It's not really showing up that much because it's in a dark area. But as it dries, I think that should be quite nice, just for interest. This is quite, should have been whiter here. The paper was too wet. So I might try and lift some of that out in a moment. And I'm just dropping some of that turquoise in. I say more for sort of interest. And that little bit there is sort of a paler area. I put that Quinn magenta in there. So I'll just drop some of that in as well. It's sometimes fun to put sort of unexpected colours in. And I think that just brightens it all up. And as long as you sort of put the tones in the right place, you're okay. Need to do this nose. Tell you what I haven't used, of course, having raved about that wonderful Perilin Violet, I realised I haven't used any of that. So I can just maybe drop some of that in, and suddenly this is becoming a very multicoloured raccoon. And why not? Quite like the idea of leaving this fairly unresolved round here. If I put that sort of more central. Let's just go back to my uncropped one. So just checking that I haven't done anything too silly, because the fun is you get carried away enjoying how the paint is playing on the surface and suddenly realise you've done something a bit dappy. So, but I think that'll be okay. I think I'm going to leave that all quite unresolved around there. And if I was cropping it, I would crop this. So this is at the top. And then you've got a calmer area here. Because if your whole painting is very busy, it gives nowhere for the eye to rest. And it can be quite sort of overwhelming for the viewer. So I think maybe having quiet area here compared to the busy area up there is a good idea. So let's have a look. I'm just going to sort those little markings out there. And make sure this comes up there. This is all still wet enough that it can move around, whereas I can see this is starting to dry over here. Okay. So I'm not particularly happy with the amount of the white that I've left there. That's better. But I need that to be dry before I can lift any more off. Let's sort the nose out now, because it's looking very funny with that sort of white nose in the middle. So again, I just go back to my reference. I'm just following the pattern of the nose. This should be dry. And that's a dark stripe going up there. It's catching the light on the top, but there are nice little flashes of sort of blue. So I'm going to put that in. And again, I'm not following the pen lines as such. because I'm not just aiming to sort of colour in the drawing, but I do want to complement them. So let's come around here. I think maybe some of that peridot violet could go here. Clean off, oops, my brush and just smooth that over. Get that there, right. And on its muzzle, it's got sort of spots where it's sort of whiskers coming out. But because, I say, this isn't quite as white as I would like it to do, I'm going to use some, have you come across magic eraser?
Yes, we have those.
You have that. So I'm just going to use a little bit of the magic eraser here. Really, I should wait for it to dry properly and then do that, because I risk damaging the paper by using it on the damp paper. But because, I'd say, watching paint dry can be rather tedious, I'm going to just risk using some of that to try and regain the white markings. And I think that's just a little bit better than it was. Right. So at that point, I think maybe I need to sort out this ear. The ear is a bit lost. I'm just putting a little mark and strengthening that. That's fine. This probably should be a bit grayer behind, looking at my reference, because all the white of these marks. So maybe putting a little bit of colour behind the raccoon, just a little bit of colour and spreading it out, just captures the edge of that ear and just defines that. I can make that a little bit stronger. So I've just got some colour behind to let that, oops, go for a bit of a walk and define a bit of the background. Maybe just a little bit over here to define this side. So at this point, I'm just playing with the colours and where they are, and I'm making it up as I go along. I'm just letting, you know, thinking, oh, have I got enough? Or I've used that colour in one place, I need to balance it with another. That was the perilline violet that I was talking about, which is a really nice colour. So it's I think it's quite funky with the turquoise. I might just add a teeny bit of turquoise down here. Now it's starting to dry, so I will end up getting lots of cauliflowers, possibly water bloom marks. I wouldn't worry about that because I rather like them and it will add to the furry appearance. But obviously, if you're not happy with them, then you should stop and wait. I think this needs to just be darker because its little eyes are really set in.
Liz?
Yes. Hi.
Hi. So it seems like the light on this photograph is... it's coming from, like, looking, the light's coming right at him, the natural light. So when you're painting, do you just creatively create what the painting needs as far as the highlights?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I am aware of where the light is coming from. And you're right, it is fairly much sort of straight on. It's obviously looking up and it's just in natural light. So it's looking up at the photographer, so the light is pretty much coming maybe slightly from the left. But yes, I would just create what I want. You know, make sure it's consistent. I think that's the most important thing. You don't want the light coming from one direction on one side and from the other on the, you know, the other. But otherwise, it's just what you fancy. I'm just gonna, sorry, just in case you're wondering, I was sorting that side out. So yes, I try and sort of, I am aware of the light, but just because the photo has light coming in one direction doesn't mean I have to have that. And if I fancy doing something different, then I will.
Mm-hmm. That's what I thought.
Yeah, you thought, she's just ignoring it.
Liz, what about the warm versus cool colors? I would have thought you would have had like warm colors on one side and cool colors on the other, but it looks like you've got them scattered around pretty much all around the painting.
Yeah, I don't tend to pay a huge amount of attention to warm and cool. I mean, I'm aware of them, but I just play with the colours as I fancy it, rather than, you know, those rules about, oh, it should be, you know, as say warm and cool and this. So I just let them play as I fancy it. So
it's not a scientific exercise. It's basically
It's not. It's all just how, you know, I kind of didn't plan it to be like this, but hey, that's how it is. So I'm you know, happy with how they're going. I really love letting watercolors do their own thing. The more you try to control them, the more they tend to rebel. So I rather enjoy letting them have their head, but still being in control.
Liz, I have a question.
Yes.
So this is a quite hairy and fluffy creature. And what if, and I like to paint dogs, and I've done a lot of fluffy dogs, but when you go to do a straight haired, flat haired dog, would you do a different method so it doesn't look so feathery? How would you approach just a straight haired dog that isn't fluffy?
Yeah, I'd work on a dry paper. I would never wet it like this because it's really uncontrollable. So I would, yes, work wet on dry. I just find a piece of, you know, so depends. I mean, if it was say, something like a Westie or something, so it's a wiry dog, you know, I might sort of do a lot of these sorts of marks and then pull the colour out so that you get some sense of its wiriness. If it was flat head, then I would work wet on dry and just grow the wash in the direction that the hair is growing, but in a far more sort of smooth way. I've gone crazy with the fur here because that's kind of what it is. But if it wasn't appropriate, I mean, if this was a long-haired cat, you'd be fine. But even if it was a short-haired cat, you wouldn't sort of do it this way. It was just quite a good excuse to have a lot of fun with watercolour and see what happened.
So basically, not a lot of water on the onset, but soften your brush strokes as you go and build.
Yes. Yeah, so I would work on a dry surface and then I'd soften my strokes, absolutely. Okay. Because it's rare that I work like this, I have to say, but it just seemed that this is a subject that's just calling out for it.
Oh, but I just love this. It's so gorgeous colors.
Well, it's great fun to do. And the lovely thing with, because you've already got the ink worked down, it gives you sort of like a scaffolding. Whereas if you just went into paper, you know, an empty sheet and just let it go like that, it would be really scary. But you've got the ink there that just gives you a little bit of security, which is nice. All I'm just doing here is dropping clean water in a few places in the hope that I will get some interesting marks. And you know what watercolour's like. It doesn't always do what you want. So, you know, sometimes you don't want water blooms and they appear. And when you do want them, they refuse. So I don't know whether this is going to behave or whether it's just going to not. We'll find out.
Excuse me again, Ralph. Rhonda was bumped out. Can you let her in again?
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I wasn't watching. I was watching the
the creature.
The creature. The bizarre creature.
The colourful creature.
It is very colourful, isn't it? Oh. I think I need to stop at this point. Where are we time-wise? So, right. So we've had an hour.
We've got an hour and a quarter or something like that left.
Yes. So I need to let that dry. I much prefer to let watercolours dry naturally if I can. And then I would love to put those whiskers in with the white and maybe lift a little bit more of the those markings. Maybe not. We'll see. So shall I put this to one side and I will grab the other one and we'll start with the watercolour first and see where that takes us. Is everyone happy with that?
Sure. Yeah.
So I say when I mean I've got a hairdryer and obviously I could dry it, yeah. And I probably will need to anyway because there's quite. Oops, sorry. There is quite a lot of water on there.
Can we take a 5-minute break?
Yeah. If that's okay, Ralph. That's fine.
5-minute break. 5-minute break.
Thank you,
Ralph.
Yes.
Hi, it's Anne. I came in late, so while we're on break and waiting, could Liz just run real quickly through a summary of what she's done to this point?
Absolutely. Yeah, no problem.
Thank you.
So what I did, basically, this is £140 cold-pressed watercolour paper I'm working on, and I'd sketched out I showed everyone the reference photo and just said that I slightly twisted it because I wanted to kind of give that inquisitive look. So that's what I'd done there. I'd sketched it out on here on the cold press paper, and I was using these sort of micron pens. Got to make sure they're waterproof, got to make sure they're light fast. So I sketched it out, said stop too soon rather than too late. So stop when you think you've done 90% of the ink work, because I can always go back in now and add more ink, but you can't take it away. So I did that, trying to keep the lines pretty loose and hopefully fairly expressive. Didn't do too much. And then I went in to the eyes and was tried to be fairly precise about doing those, but then I wet the entire paper and put the paint on to really get those lovely fluffy edges to the raccoon, and got a bit carried away with the colours by the looks of things. But that's the joy of it, that you can, and how different it would be. So this was, you know, my practice one that I did before. And then actually, I really love the sort of the purpley sort of violet colours coming through, which I'm rather enjoying. And that's kind of got to where we are. So I was just saying that you want the watercolour and the ink to sort of add up so that it's not just a coloured in drawing or an outlined painting. Obviously needs its whiskers, which now this is pretty much dry. I can put in when people come back. You know, if at this point I think, oh, I should have put in more ink, I can do that. If I think I should have put in more paint, I can do that. And as long as I sort of balance those layers and make sure things are dry in between, I can add it up. But as I say, what's so much harder is to take away. So that in a nutshell is where we've got to.
Thank you. Are your markers alcohol or water-based?
So these have got pigment ink, so it's water-based.
Okay, thank you.
But they dry, they are waterproof, so they will not move when I put the watercolor over the top. So it is pigment ink, not dye-based ink. And they are UV resistant, so they will not fade with time.
And we will, we are recording this, so you'll be able to view, you know, what happened up till now, except for the first 20 minutes, which I forgot to record.
Okay, thank you.
Are we all back?
I think so.
Okay, given that we had that little break, I did hair dryer it all. So it's pretty much, so we might as well just actually finish this before going on to the other one. So it was, say, when, you know, at this point, if you think, oh, if only I put more ink on, well, you can. Or, oh, if only there was more colour, of course you can do that. I'm just going to just sort these little white marks around the eyes. They're a bit too clunky. And just do that. Might just darken a tiny bit. Where did I think? Probably here. So that's just adding a tiny bit of colour there. And then I searched out some white pens. They're not so... I don't know. I presume you have Posca pens in the States. They're a paint marker. This is Kohinoor, which I think is Turkish, actually. Again, I'm not sure if you have Kohinoor in...
I think I've heard of it.
You have heard of it. Oh, that's lovely. Good. So we could try those and see if they are opaque enough.
Oh, yeah.
It sort of shows, doesn't it? But if I wasn't happy with that as a mark, then I have squeezed a little bit of white gouache here. And I've got a rigger brush, so I'm just adding a little bit of water to make it a little bit more fluid, sticking in big lump. I've got a rigger brush, and now I need to do this confidently because you only get one chance. Oops, she says you only get one chance, doing it twice, just to get a few of those whiskers in. This is a little bit not quite as fine as I would like, but the whiskers do make a huge difference, so I thought if we got those in it would make me happy. You know that I've put the whiskers in with the black ink, just to sort of have them there. So I'm not covering all the whiskers, but just getting a little, because he's definitely a very whiskery chap.
I think those add a lot to it.
They do, don't they? It's these really? Little touches. And of course, if you want to, you could always put little white marks somewhere else if you've lost highlights, if you've lost the highlight in the eye. You know, if you say you looked at the ears and thought, oh, that would benefit. Gosh, not that mark. That's horrible. But you can always take it off again. So you can do that, but you need to restrain yourself, because if you're using gouache or gouache, as I guess you should call it, the danger is that it always looks added on, always looks a little bit clunky. And if you do too much, it, you know, doesn't do you any favours. A finer pen is nice, but I don't know what's wrong with this pen. It's got one of those sort of valves in it, and it tends to get terribly, either you get a splodge or you get nothing. So I think I need to treat myself to another one. So as we discussed, you could scrape these out, but it would have to be bone dry, this paper, and it's still damp. But, you know, if you wanted to, you could do that. I could have masked the whiskers, but I don't like masking fluid. I find it very clunky, and it would stop the flow of the... the paint, so I'd much prefer just to add things on at the end and be done with it. I need to stop, tell myself to stop, because the danger is that you think, oh, I'll keep doing. But as long as I've got the sort of feeling of whiskers, I think that's fine. So that would be my sort of raccoon there. Yeah,
nice.
Now, looking at the time, we've got, let's see whether we can do a little bit of speed painting, hey? So again, I've sketched out this raccoon. I've put it rather more to the left on this piece of paper, just because I thought it would make it a bit different. And we could start with the paint this time. I'm going to keep, for time's sake, I will keep the paints that I've already got in my palette, but we'll use different combinations and let's see how different this will be. So let's use, that's the burnt umber, rather before I use the sienna and the French ultramarine. So let's mix up the burnt umber and the ultramarine, just gives a slightly different dark. Let's make sure I mix plenty of that up. And let me show you that on my piece of paper.
Are you going to wet the paper?
Well, I'm just making my mind up, because I'm thinking that if I wet the whole paper, I love the furry edge it gives, but it's about drying, because I cannot put pen onto it until it's dry. And so I am going to do a different method. I think that would be a good thing, so that you get two demos for the price of one. I think that might be a best idea. So
Christmas special.
I know. Lucky you. Or not, as the case may be. So again, I've got this sketched out. It's looking somewhat strange. I'm wondering what haven't I got right. No, we'll see. I am going to start with the eyes again, because I just always start with the eyes. And I'm using that burnt umber, whereas before it was all based around the sienna. I'm leaving those little highlights. Didn't actually, no need to mask. I'm going to treat myself to a clean bit of kitchen towel. How exciting. And just bring the eye round into these gorgeous dark markings. So I'm going to paint somewhat more traditionally, just to manage some of the amount of water that I've got on the paper, because if I did it like I did the last one, I think we could be here, well, it'd be midnight our time and it'd be your lunchtime by the time it dried. So let's just, I'm not aiming to do a full painting, full watercolour painting, because I still want there to be place for the ink to do its job. Oh, I could try, if I was being careful, maybe I could actually paint round some of the whiskers and just leave a suggestion of the whiskers for later. I will still need to add more on, but just even leaving a bit of a suggestion of the whiskers might be a good idea. Again, you can do that. So I'm using this dark mix. I might not be able to restrain myself from adding in some other colours. It's sad, isn't it? I start off painting something and think, oh, I'm going to do this far more realistic. Yeah, realistic colours. And then it's like, oh, but I love turquoise. Oh, yeah, it's got to have turquoise. So I will try and restrain myself, but I don't think it's going to work. Oh, look, there's some turquoise. Ah, couldn't help it. Just put it in there. So I don't, you know, this is super soft and furry, but let's try and keep these markings a little better this time. I'm using a particularly silly size brush, so let's move up a size. And we will use that spray to get the lovely soft furry edges this time. So I'm just watching the markings. That's got to be a lot darker than coming down the center, because this is more gray, isn't it, than the dark. So let's just water that down a bit, and then it comes down into the nose. And then we can go up round here, and we're back into the dark of this side. Just be careful that I don't splosh that eye and let it all merge in too much. Just indicate a couple of those. I think it might be quite nice just to have a few of those whiskers.
Lost and found whiskers.
Yes, exactly. I'm going to have to be careful round the eye because it's still wet, and just so it doesn't all merge in, leaving little flashes of white of the paper so that we don't lose those. Right. And then, as I say, I can't restrain myself, so I'm going to have some turquoise that side as well. And then we're coming round back to my nice big brush, coming round up into the ear. It's very dark in that centre of the ear, so let's do that. But again, just trying to join on shapes rather than think, oh, I'm painting an ear. I'm painting patterns and shapes, and we'll come down here like that. And then it's very dark under its chin, isn't it? I'm not sure on the other one that I got it quite dark enough. Oh, let's put a whisker down there. I forgot about those, so at least pretend that they're there. And then that can sort of join on, and then it goes up. Right. And some dark up here. So I am trying to follow that pattern, but now I'm going to use that little spray and let some of this colour go for a walk and get those furry edges, but just in a bit more controlled way than we did on the first painting. So, you know, there are so many different ways to paint, aren't there? And that's the joy of it. We can adapt. So I'm going to hopefully get some nice furry marks around the edges, but more controlled in the centre. And that will give more space for the pen to do a bit of that work for us. As I say, I couldn't resist the turquoise, one of my favourite colours. So this is the famous San Diego turquoise raccoon. sorry about that. And I'm sticking in some of that Perilin violet as well, because I just can't resist it either. I do need to break up the edges of these markings because they're not straight, and we tell detail at the edges so much more. You know, if you look at a tree, you can see the leaf patterns at the edges, but not in the centre. And it's just, you can see at the edges of the markings, the sort of furry sort of patterns rather than sort of in the centre. Right, need to get that nose in, and then particularly the nostrils. And I'm really trying not to be too precise here, because I know I've got the pen that can come and hopefully regain control out of any chaos. I hope. It's a magic pen. That mouth is obviously very dark. You've got bit of shadow sort of going on down here. And and sort of joins on there. And in terms of paint, probably don't need an awful lot more than that. Again, as I say, if you stop too soon, I can always add more paint later, but again, harder to take it away. I would like to soften its lovely hairy tummy here. Well, it's not tummy, chest, I should say.
Yeah, the face is the important part in this, it seems like, and you can just kind of sketch out the outer limits of the body and not worry about it too much.
Absolutely. And it's deciding, you know, what you want to say. Oh, look, see if that's going for a nice little walk. Now, it's deciding, you know, what is important, what will tell you that this is a raccoon, and what will, you know, actually the body just isn't terribly important. Obviously, you don't want it just floating in nothing. I am looking at over here. I've got some very nasty hard edges that I do need to get rid of.
Makes me think of the Cheshire Cat disappearing into the background.
Oh, yes. Yeah, absolutely. Just leaving its smile.
Yes.
Right.
It's the Cheshire Raccoon.
Yes. So, I'm struggling again. I'm sorry, in our 5 minute break, I should have gone and got a better spray bottle. I've got hundreds of these things and they suddenly give up on you. They're really annoying. Right. Okay, so I've got a really loose painting down there. And if I was just relying on watercolour at this point, I might well be panicking. But I know I've got my lovely friend, the ink, that hopefully is going to come to my rescue and resolve some of this sort of chaos. So I need to dry this. I'm just putting in a little bit more of that turquoise just to balance things up. But I just need to dry this and then come back in with the pen. So if you will excuse me for hopefully just a couple of minutes. Zoom will cancel out the sound of the hairdryer and I will be back with you in a second. Right. So checking that it's dry, I mean, I've got a wet area here, but I will do that last and hopefully it'll be dry by that point. So I'm just grabbing my pens again. And it's a case of, you know, not quite in reverse of what we did, but so looking and thinking, right, where do I need some pen work that will add to this? So I'm not just outlining my painting, I'm looking and thinking, okay, what needs defining? What can stay? Where do I need to add control? Where can I leave something unresolved? Sorry, that pen isn't happy. I think this is still a little bit damp, unfortunately, but never mind. We'll carry on. As you saw from my box, I have got loads and loads and loads of pens. So if I have to get through them all, we'll be fine. You will find sometimes the watercolour almost clogs the pen. So doing it this way, you may have a few more problems than doing it the other. It won't damage it. It will all sort of come back in a moment, but it can sort of just slightly clog the flow of the ink. So I hope you can see that sort of straight away, just adding even little touches of ink, it just adds a little bit of definition. Say, I'm slightly struggling on top of this watercolour, so I'm going to let that dry a bit more and come to a different area that hopefully is a bit drier. So let's go round to the nose. And again, I'm trying to vary my marks and keep them fairly fluid. And again, I need to follow my own advice. And if you hold your pen a little bit further down the barrel, you tend to get a looser mark than if you get too sort of at the end and you press too hard, and the whole sort of lines start to tighten up and become less expressive. So I will try and follow my own advice, but you tend to sort of get very caught up in what you're doing, and the more you concentrate, you find your hand sort of zooms down the barrel. So coming down into the mouth, it is very dark under there. So I might want to I could go back in with more watercolour, or I could use the pen to sort of darken that down. It's quite grey and toned sort of under the nose, because of course they've got quite pointed snouts, haven't they, these raccoons. So I need to sort of do that. And again, I'm just going to put in some more whiskers. I know they're white, but I can make it up. So this is a 0.5 that I'm using now, just because I was having difficulty with the watercolour slightly clogging the finer pen. So I can come down. Didn't do an awful lot with the ears, with the watercolour, so I can come round here, but I have actually got some really quite pretty sort of marks in the ears, so I don't want to do too much. And I might come back with a bit more watercolour behind the ear, or no, actually I won't, because I did that on the other one. So let's try and do this in as different way as possible from the first one, just to do show that. So if you've not done much pen and wash before and you're not sure whether you want to do pen first or watercolour first, what I'd recommend is getting a really simple subject. So a lemon, orange, you know, something from the fruit bowl or the vegetable rack, and starting with a drawing of it. So start with the pen first and then adding watercolour, and then doing it the other way round, of starting with the watercolour and then adding pen work. And even though it's a really simple subject, it actually teaches you an awful lot about the sort of different possibilities. So yeah, just raid your fruit bowl or your vegetable rack, and that's a really good place to start. And you can try very loose drawings, you can try very detailed, precise drawings, you can try, you know, again, very precise watercolour, or sort of splashing it on, and working out what your personal style and preference is, just from that really simple subject. So if I'm running a line and wash sort of workshop or something, that's what I usually get people to do as a starter. We quite often do lemons, because at least they make the studio smell delicious. You can do an onion, but it'll make you cry. any sort of interest, just simple shape, but enough sort of interest in it. And that's what I would sort of recommend, getting used to the idea of what do I want to do, pen first, watercolour first. And that works really nicely. This is still a bit damp down here, so I've just got to be careful.
Liz.
Yes. Hi.
Hi. Do you ever use different colored inks, like brown or whatever? If you do a lemon, do you use like orange ink?
I don't tend to use colored inks. I occasionally will use sepia, particularly if I'm doing sort of more of an urban sketch and it's an older sort of, you know, cottage or quite a rustic sort of subject. I just find if you use coloured inks and coloured washes, it almost becomes an orgy of colour. It's too much going on. So sort of keeping it a little bit more simplified with just the black ink, I find more pleasing. However, just every so often, again, you know, the last thing you want to do is to get stuck in a rut. So I will occasionally use coloured lines and really work hard to sort of balance things and make sure it doesn't become that sort of orgy of colour. So gel pens can be, you know, good fun for that sort of work. I've even got sort of like little glittery gel pens and things. So I've done sort of more line and wash doodles that have been good fun just when you want to try something a bit different. But on the whole, I think it all just gets too busy if you have, say, coloured ink, coloured watercolour, all just gets a bit too much. Have you used different coloured inks?
Only when I want to do something I've never done before, like Tombows. I have a set of Tombows.
Yeah, Tombows. What have you got, the brush pens or the dual tip ones? Or
the brush pens.
Yes. I mean, they are lovely. The problem with Tombows is that they're not light fast. So they're great for sort of sketches or sketchbook work, but they're not UV resistant. It's something to just watch out for.
Okay.
So what you find is dye-based inks tend to fade after a while. So anything in sort of felt tip pens, drawing inks, artist drawing inks are all dye-based. So they're beautiful colours, but they're not UV resistant. Whereas pigment inks, which is what's in here, they're UV resistant, but they don't tend to be available in as many nice colours. So sadly, yeah, you what you win on one hand, you lose on the other, which is a great shame. So I don't know if you have all those beautiful Winsor & Newton drawing inks that come in the tiny, beautiful little bottles, but they will fade with time. And they're a bit naughty because they don't really make that clear. A lot of the pen manufacturers don't make it clear that their pens aren't permanent, which I think is not right. You really have to sort of read their technical sheets or, you know, really look into what's going on. And I think they should just be a lot more upfront about it. Do you have Elegant Writer pens?
I just purchased a fountain pen. I haven't got it yet. It has a tip on it that has a 50 degree angle.
Oh, a foodie nib.
Yeah, foodie. Yeah.
Yes. Oh, great fun. So you need to be careful with fountain pen inks, because most fountain pen inks aren't waterproof.
Okay.
And are again are not permanent, light resistant. Okay. So you can get platinum carbon ink is waterproof, so you have to be careful not to let it dry in your fountain pen.
How about India ink?
You can't put Indian ink in a fountain pen because the particles in it will clog the mechanism.
Yes. So with a nib, you could use it with a separate nib with a...
Yeah, a dip pen, no problem, but a fountain pen, definitely. Yeah, Indian ink in a fountain pen is a recipe for disaster, especially if it's some wonderful, you know, some fountain pens are amazing, and, you know, your Mont Blanc fountain pen or something that's cost you a couple of thousand pounds, you'd be very upset You just put Indian ink in it. So you have to make sure it's fountain pen ink, but very few fountain pen inks are actually water proof. And a lot of them aren't UV resistant. You can get what's called registrar's ink, which in the UK is literally what the registrar registers births, deaths and marriages. So they use registrar's ink that lasts for 100 years minimum. So that is okay in fountain pens. Will last 100 years. So if it fades after that, someone's going to have to sort of dig me out of my grave to sue me. So that's fine. But you just got to be really careful with your inks and know what you're buying. So I'm sort of scribbling away really as we're talking, which is probably a good thing because it will stop me getting too fussy. It might stop me concentrating. So if this has suddenly turned into something different, I shall blame the fact that we've been chatting. And then you've got to think, right, when do I stop? And the moment to stop is when you've achieved what you set out to achieve. You know, does it look, I'm not sure it does particularly look like a, there's something dodgy about its eyes.
That's the way they are.
Pardon?
That's the way they are, dodgy.
Is it? You see, I, on the whole, I tend to only draw animals I'm familiar with so that you understand a little bit about their behaviour and their personalities. So I feel at a slight loss because, as I say, I don't relate to raccoons either in the loving or hating them sort of field. But yes, I just, when you've, you know, achieved what you set out to achieve, whether that was to catch a quizzical look or a furry body or whatever, that's the point when you start saying, right, I should stop, because you can go too far and then really regret it.
I like this one where the line work is coming in and out of the gray and medium colored areas and so forth. It really has a nice feel to it.
Yeah, I think it's nice that I said right at the beginning that the last thing I want to do is a painting and then just outline it. Because if I just went round the color, kind of, so what was the point of it? Whereas if the line work can bring something to the party, then I think that's really positive. I do think there's an area here where I need to add a little bit more colour. This straight line is really unpleasant. So all I need to do is break that up, and that will, I think, hopefully that will help. And I think probably then I'm just going to use a little bit of water to sort of bring some of that colour because it was just too white over there. I do wonder under the nose that I need a little bit more watercolour just to give a bit more sort of shape there. So, but I can do that because this ink just dries pretty much instantly. And I do wonder, again, just a little bit more over there, because I know that the body of the raccoon is sort of greyish. So just implying that, and I'm using the rigger to get a different mark that almost echoes the mark I've been doing with the pen. And that yes. might just be enough.
Did you say you do people portraits too?
Yes.
Okay.
In a very similar style, my poor people quite often turn out turquoise too.
So do you have a website?
Yes. My website is www.lizchatterton.co.uk, or if I don't know if you're on Facebook or Instagram. A lot more of my sort of stuff is on there because on my website, it's really only work that I've got for sale. And once it's sold, I sort of take it off my website. So probably social media is a good place to look for other stuff.
Okay.
What I'd just like to do, I'd like to do a tiny bit of spatter round its nose for where the little points where the whiskers come out. So I'm just going to put a bit of kitchen towel sort of there to protect and just do a little bit of splatter there because I don't want this to go too far. Just to do that, I felt it was just a bit boring and sort of stark there. And now I just want to pop in some more of those white whiskers. So let's see. Oops. I'll go back to the gouache that I've got there. It's dried up, so I'm just going to add a little bit of water to just loosen it up. And I've got that rigger brush. So we've got sort of indications that we put in of the whiskers, but there's a lovely whisker here that goes up round sort of the back there. So I think that would be a nice one. Just make sure that's not too thick. Just to put that in. Because I've left so much white here, some of these whiskers are not going to show up. Because you're always looking at contrast. We were talking about watercolour pencils earlier. That's too thick. Let's just smooth that down. I could even use watercolour pencils. Oh, I could have turquoise whiskers. Now that would be fun. I might get carried away again. So in this case, because I have left so much white, I've got some, these are watercolour pencils, so they're Derwent ink tents, but any watercolour pencil, let's grab those out of there. And let's see, I haven't got a decent turquoise, sadly, but I could just use that blue. And if I'm doing something like whiskers, what I do is just dip them in the water and you get a richer colour. Because I don't find that they're brilliant on their own. So I could just, it's a shame it isn't turquoise, but it's not. So there you go. I mean, quite often you have to just compromise, don't you? Because it would be nice if you had every single colour in the world and you had every single art material in the world, but we don't. So to compromise and to make things work regardless is part of our job as an artist. You know, we're always problem solving. Oh, that bit went wrong. How can I resolve it? How can I make it look better? How can I, you know, I've only got this colour and she had that colour. Well, fine. Just, you know, make it work because we kind of got to. So because I put blue whiskers on, I'm just introducing a little bit of that colour in a few other places so that it doesn't look too out of keeping. Because the danger is your eye will get caught in a place. So I'm just echoing a few of those sort of wiggly marks in a few other places just to balance things up. And I might just put a little bit there. So I'm dipping it in the water again and it stops it looking too pencil-y and makes it look a little bit more painterly. So I'm not that fond of watercolour pencils, but they can be useful. Right, and I think I would probably stop at this point, she says, carrying on. I always say that. Oh, I'm just going to stop. And then you think, oh, no, I'll just do that. The danger of fiddling is just overwhelming. but I will stop. Let me put that down.
Yes, we have an artist named Bob Burridge over here who's presented several workshops I've witnessed. And one of his questions was, how do you know when to stop? And he says, he always names his paintings first. He says, you know, this is, you know, Wily Raccoon or something like that. And then when it matches, when the painting matches the title, then you're done.
Exactly. I don't do that, but I always think before I start, why do I want to paint this? And if it is, I mean, obviously the answer is because Ralph asked me to, but the other answer is, you know, I want to capture a twinkle in its eye, or I want to capture its whiskery face. And if you've done that, that's when you stop. Because if I look at it tomorrow morning and think, oh, I should have done more, I can. But if I look at it tomorrow morning and think, oh, God, Liz, you really got carried away there, then I can't. I can't do much about that. So, yeah, I like the idea of naming them, but I don't do that, but I might from now on. All I was going to say is I haven't actually taken my underdrawing pencil out because we were sort of pushing through. I won't do it now because this is still wet in places, but as a general rule, I would take out the pencil marks because, as I say, I want to give the illusion that I'm cleverer than I am. So I would take those out, and that often does make quite a difference. Yeah, I say I'm going to damage the paper if I try and take those ones out over there. But say that big line there, I can take right out.
Liz, can you put them side by side?
Just what I was going to suggest. Excellent, because I think it's just fun to, let me grab. It's just fun to say, well, they both fit. I'm not sure they're a bit too big to fit. Can you see those roughly?
Yes.
And then to say, right, so what do I like about one and what don't I like about the other? Or because then if I ever did this again, I can combine, you know, the best of what, you know, those things. So I really love the deeper colours here and the soft edges. And in fact, that's still not quite dry. That I think works. I do quite like this colour combination of the turquoise with that was the mix of burnt umber and French ultramarine. I'm quite enjoying that. I'm thinking, oh, I might use that as colour combination in something totally different. I don't like this mark round here. Now I'm looking at it, it's a bit blobby. So once we stop here, I might have a little fiddle and just sort that out. So you start looking at things, but let me actually get my practice one. I'm just conscious that's still wet and I don't want to put something. So then I've got, again, a different one there, haven't I? So to do the same subject in two or three ways and work out what you like the most. Mm-hmm. And whether that's colour, whether that's technique, whether that's, well, whatever it is a really, really good discipline. I have a Facebook group that I run, which anyone is welcome to join. And we do a different challenge each month. And actually, the challenge I set this month was to do the same subject two different ways, because I think it's so valuable to either use maybe a different medium. So you could do a subject in pure watercolour and do one in pen and wash, or in acrylic and watercolour, or ink and watercolour, or just to use the same medium and then change the colours round or change your method round. And you learn a huge amount, and it really helps you develop your own style, because you think, yeah, love that, hate that, I'll do more of this, less of that, I'm never ever doing this that again in my life. And you learn and you teach yourself and develop your style and refine it.
Liz, so, what's the address for your Facebook group?
It is called, oh, I should know this. Can I send you the link? Because I can't for the life of me remember what it is.
I'll send it out to everybody too.
Yeah, I'll send you the link. But please, if you fancy joining it, and there's people in there from everywhere. There's Australians, Americans, Canadians. I've got someone from Iceland, couple of Israelis. There's all sorts. And it's really friendly folk, ever so supportive. And I say we do a different challenge. Last month we did painting with coffee. So we used instant coffee to paint light watercolour, and people did some brilliant work. Or you can just share what you're doing or ask for tips but I'll send you that link. And as I say, this month I've set them the challenge of doing the same thing two different ways, because I think you learn a lot. You know, I couldn't repeat a painting to save my life anyway because of the way I paint, so even if I tried to copy one, it always turns out different. But I do think you learn a lot from trying something in different ways. Can you see those? The conclusion is, you know, when people say which comes first, is it the pen or the wash? Well, the answer is whatever you fancy. And you can always build it up. But the effects do be different. Often the medium that you use first is the most dominant. I don't actually think it probably is in these. They're quite balanced. But sometimes, you know, if I do the ink first, it tends to be a lot more detailed and the watercolour doesn't do so much. And usually if I do the watercolour first, that's the dominant medium, but I think they're probably fairly balanced at the moment. But that's also because we painted with a time constraint. So I've not been able to get as carried away as I might otherwise.
They're beautiful.
Yeah. Yes,
it's just a whole wonderful. Infestation of them.